just walking through it, knowing that you're with me. This is your world. I'm just living in it.
Yo, yo, what's going on, church family? How's everybody on this Sunday morning? Yeah, it's so good to be here this morning, man. Super fired up to be here. We're going to be talking about a subject that I think we all need to hear this morning, and especially I did. And want to encourage you today. Just want to encourage you today to experience the love and the presence of God. How do you do that? Well, I'll tell you how you do it. It's by surrendering and letting go. Just letting go, man. Just coming in here and letting go and letting God have his way in this church service today. I believe God wants to do something incredible today. I believe God wants to work miracles in your life today. But sometimes the hardness of our hearts drives the Holy Spirit away. We can't have that, right? Joy. Joy. Right? The Lord is my strength and my salvation. Of whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? We fear nothing, church. We walk in the power and the glory of who God is. My brothers and sisters are up here, man, because they've been called by God, ordained by God, to lead us into the throne room of grace this morning. So I want to encourage you this morning. You can stand, you can sit, you can kneel, you can spin around and twirl, whatever you want to do. But let's worship and praise the Lord this morning. Amen? Amen. Let's get this party started.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, oh, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name, power in your name. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance.
That song, did you believe
yes.
the words of that song? It's different when you believe it, because then you can really sing it. You can really sing it, man. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit wants to break loose today, church. He wants to break loose, man. I felt compelled to just come to the altar and sing that song. I don't know why. If you feel compelled to come to the altar and sing, sing. But be free. Free in Jesus today. Amen.
earth gives way, for the risen one is overcome. And for every fear, there's an empty grave, for the risen one is overcome. We will not be moved when the earth gives way. Speak to me now. You have won my attention. I will linger and listen. I can't miss a thing. Because, Lord, I know my heart wants more of you. My heart wants something new. So I surrender all. Undone by who you are, my desire is to know you deeper. Lord, I will open up again, throw my fears into the wind. I am desperate for a touch of heaven. Oh, oh. Breath in my soul, the life in my bones. There is no hesitation in your love and affection. It's the sweetest of all. Lord, I know my heart wants more of you. My heart wants something new, so I surrender. Oh, 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 oh.
Trading in my phone.
and lay down everything, 'cause you're all that I want. I've landed on my knees. This is the cup you have for me.
And even when it don't make sense, I'm gonna let your spirit lead. I'm gonna let your spirit lead.
Spirit lead.
I'm gonna let your spirit lead.
Spirit lead.
I'm gonna let your spirit lead.
Spirit lead.
Just saturating our souls with who you are.
Thank you
for being here with us and just drawing us closer to you right now, Lord. Thank you. That's all we can say is thank you. We just love you so much, and we thank you for doing the things that you're about to do and the things that you have just done through worship. Be with Pastor as he brings forth your word. Let it continue that deep saturation into our souls and into our lives, Lord. Bless him and speak through him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everybody. Man, thank you, worship team, for leading us to the throne. I appreciate it, man. Just your willingness to just open your hearts and your lives and bless us with your fingers and voices. And before we get started, I want to share with you something that's very, very concerning. So I think most of you know we support an organization called Pacific Justice Institute. I've known Brad Dacus for about 22 years. He helped me a lot when I was the director of Youth for Christ. They're basically on the forefront of fighting legal battles for Christian organizations and fighting against things that just aren't right. We received a letter from him yesterday that Pat and I could not believe, and so I want to share with you what it says. Dear friend, as many of you know, one of the core concerns and reasons that I founded the Pacific Justice Institute 25 years ago was to protect children from being unlawfully taken away from their parents. At PGI, we've battled horrific instances of the government trying to break up families. By God's grace, we've saved countless children from the clutches of unscrupulous social workers. But never have I seen such a brazen, all-out assault on families as what we're battling right now with California Senate Bill 107. Never did I think we would see the day when California would seek to steal children from their parents, even in other states, all in the name of advancing transgender rights. For years, we've warned that what happens in California doesn't stay in California. This is a chilling example of that prediction. You see, SB 107 actually encourages troubled parents who lose custody in conservative states like Texas to take the child in violation of court orders and flee to California. Ordinarily, this prompts an all-out search or an Amber Alert to make sure the child is safe. In all too many situations, such taking of children ends in tragedy. Why would California endanger not only its own children, but children nationwide? Incredibly, SB 107 creates an exception to kidnapping laws if the unfit or unstable adult claims they are taking the child in order to give them dangerous hormone treatments or other transgender services that have been outlawed by conservative states. Because this bill is so extreme, PJI, Center for Public Policy, sent an opposition letter to the offices of all elected legislators in the Golden State, urging them to reject this insane measure. We also take pains to document our concerns directly from the bill itself. Consider, for instance, what the nonpartisan but left-leaning Legislative Council's digest gives as the official summary for part of the bill. The bill will additionally prohibit a court from considering the taking or retention of a child from a person who has legal custody of the child if the taking or retention was for obtaining gender-affirming health care or mental health care. Let that sink in for a moment. California is actually condoning the abduction of children to advance an ideological agenda. In the same bill, other provisions declare that California will not cooperate with law enforcement in other states who attempt to rescue these innocent children. I wish I could tell you that this is just a rumor or an idea so extreme that no one will actually support it. But I need you to understand the gravity of this situation. In fact, the legislation is supported by powerful senators who are determined to unleash this evil on all of us. Over the last several years, many families have left California because our lawmakers are oppressive and overreaching. But under SB 107, even families who have moved to Texas and Florida, Tennessee, Idaho, and many other conservative states will no longer be safe. Now is the time for us to take a stand and tell California, hands off of our kids. We must unequivocally draw a line in the sand. We will not let our kids and grandkids be taken away and subjected to medical experimentation in the name of transgender rights. The single most effective way you and I can work to defeat this bill is to join in the fight in the courthouses and state houses nationwide. We presently have 20 offices in 20 states, and we work closely with the pro-life groups across the country to defeat monstrous bills like SB 107. So write your senator, write your congressman, write your local representatives and tell them, This is a no-no. Church, we got to wake up, man. We sit here and put our heads in the sand, and we act like everything's okay, and it's not okay. I'm telling you right now, this one got me, particularly because of my grandchildren. I got a bunch of them. And I've got some in Texas. I've got some in California. I've got some in New Jersey. And to think that if something happened and one of my kids got unstable for whatever reason and thought that this type of stuff is okay, it's not. So pick up your phone. Y'all are on your phones all day anyways. And email your congressman or whoever it is and tell them this bill is outrageous. This is an atrocity. They are trying to destroy our families. They want control of our children so that they can raise the children the way they want them raised with these ridiculous ideologies, man. But I'm telling you, there's more of us than them. But the more of us shut up and don't say anything. Be vocal and let them know this is not cool. Because think about it. If this passes in California, it's going to happen everywhere else. And nobody's going to be safe. That's just the reality of it. So I don't mean to start off on a sour note, but man, Pat and I couldn't believe it. When she was reading it to me when we were driving, I just like, you got to be kidding me. How can this be? So, all right, let's rock and roll, man. So, hey, we're in part three of A Sound Mind. It's a series that we're talking about or going through, and we're talking about the mind, and we're talking about how the mind works, I guess, from the perspective of the Bible. And we saw that the battle is fought in the mind, how Satan attacks us, how Satan wants to destroy our thinking on who we are and who God is. And today I want to talk to those of you who have lost some of your spiritual passion. You've lost your spiritual passion. At one time, you were close to God, man. You were walking so closely to God. You were spiritually growing. You knew God was working in your life. You saw the evidence of God's work in your life. You sensed His presence. But now, all of a sudden, you're at a place in your life where you've lost your passion. You've lost that intimacy. And for some of you, you've even lost your faith. And I understand. As your pastor, I understand. And one of the things that is so powerful about our lives is the fact that we can share our lives as a testimony to what God has done in our lives, what Jesus has done in our lives. Mine and Pat's story started on February 17th, 1991. It's 11:45 in the morning. We came snot-faced crying to Jesus. Gave our lives to the Lord, surrendered it. We've never looked back. And it was God over everything in the beginning. I mean, with me and Mama Bear, it was God. I mean, we cut the cord on our TV, man. I mean, we did all sorts of crazy stuff, man. But it was just all about God. And, man, I wore those cheesy T-shirts, those cheesy Jesus T-shirts and stuff, and cheesy hats and just cheesy stuff, boy. It was just cheesy, 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 right? And my enthusiasm, right, it overrode what I didn't know. I was just enthusiastic about God. I was enthusiastic about the fact that God had called me from the dirt and grime that I was as a person into a loving relationship with Him. It was crazy to think that God loved me like that. Because my whole life I was just searching to be loved like that. And finally I encounter it in Sacramento, California on the 17th of February. And it was about 6 months later that I started feeling something stirring in my spirit. And then I had this verse that came to me around 12 o'clock at night. I had gotten up and started reading the Bible. And it was a verse talking about being anointed and being called. I started thinking, man, God, what are you calling me to? And then more and more I would read the Word, and I felt like God was calling me to pastor. And then I had other pastors that I knew and that I was under that would tell me the very same thing. And so I'm feeling like I've got this call, right? But here I am working for the probation department. I'm working inside of juvenile hall. And this call isn't happening. And then I get promoted to a supervisor inside juvenile hall, and then things started kind of moving, man. I started planning churches and started doing outreach ministries. And I served in churches as an elder and a worship leader. And then I was the director for Youth for Christ for a while. And that was an amazing, it was just a blast, okay? In 2007, I get ordained as a pastor. It's finally happened. 2007, I get ordained. And you would think I had it all going on. But like I shared with you last week, 2 months after being ordained, my life crashed. It crashed. It crashed. I didn't like the church. I didn't like its people. I didn't like God. I didn't want anything to do with God. I didn't want anything to do with the church. I was mad and upset because everything that I had built on was false. The passion that I once had was great, but it crumbled. Because I had built it on something that wasn't real. I tried to build it on myself. Like I shared with you last week, 3 years on the sidelines, then 2 years I'm leading small groups, and then the Lord tells me to come and spend a Sunday with Pastor John that was here before me. And I'd help John plant this church. And the first words out of his mouth was how much help he needed. And I was like, oh, Lord, I don't want to hear that. And then we started sporadically coming back, and then finally we came back. 2016, John comes to see me for lunch, and we start talking, and he's like, man, dude, I'm just not feeling this anymore, man. And we started talking about me taking over as the pastor here. We prayed for 6 months. It wasn't like, okay, let's do it. I did not want to do it. I'm telling you, I didn't want to do it. I'm like, I don't want to go through the nonsense of ministry again. If you've never been in ministry, you have no idea what I'm talking about. But ministry, let me tell you something. It is a war zone. People don't like what you say. They don't like the way you look. They don't like this. They don't like that. They don't like the lights. They don't like the chairs. They don't like the carpet. They don't like the band. They don't like this. They don't like that. It's a constant attack. I'm like, God, I don't want to do this. But the Lord kept saying, no. Come on, let's go. And I started feeling a passion coming. I started feeling an enthusiasm coming. And finally I knew that God was in it because I started feeling enthusiastic about it. Pat and I stepped out and we took the church. And I will tell you, and I've told you this before, this is the most difficult ministry I've ever been in my life at the Refuge. It has been hard. It's been hard. Probably a lot of it is me. But it's been a hard ministry. And I go from wanting to be here to not wanting to be here. From wanting to be here to not wanting to be here. And I just go back and forth sometimes. And then I realized I put down on my notes a few weeks back, but it was actually a few months back. I had realized that I was in this stale point in my life. And I was complaining. This building took its toll on me. This building really did. Can we afford it? Can we get it done in time? Is the city going to give us permits? We still don't have fiber. We're not streaming right now. Right? We got to record it and send it out at 6 o'clock. But it took its toll. Why? Not because I wanted this building for me. I wanted it for you. I wanted you to have a place that you could come and be comfortable and be loved. It took its toll. And man, I was in Complainville. And the Lord said, man, why are you complaining about something you've prayed for and had a passion for? Why? Some of you this morning are complaining. You're complaining about something you've prayed for and had a passion for. Well, today, the title of this message is Get Your Passion Back. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. Lord, thank you for my brothers and sisters, Lord, and thank you that you're a God that encourages us. Lord, that doesn't leave us where we're at, but desires us first to grow and to change. So, Lord, you are the potter and we are the clay. And we come here this morning to to the potter, saying, Lord, shape us and form us what you want us to be. Holy Spirit, guide us this morning. Speak to us, and we thank you. It's in Jesus' name. And all the saints said, Amen. So we're in this series, A Sound Mind. And today, I want to talk to you about passion and enthusiasm. Passion and enthusiasm. And the first thing I want to talk about is there's two types of people when it comes to passion and enthusiasm. The first one, if you could bring it up on the screen, those who let circumstances influence their enthusiasm. Did you catch what that says? Those who let the circumstances influence their enthusiasm. So it's what's going on around you that makes you enthusiastic or not enthusiastic. The second one is this: those who use their enthusiasm to influence their circumstances. Totally different. It's your enthusiasm that influences what's going on around you. Now, this word enthusiasm, it comes from a Greek word called entheos. Entheos. It means in God or filled with God. Right? That's what enthusiasm means. So to have enthusiasm means I'm filled with God. I'm in God. I'm filled with God. Church, this is born out of an intimacy with God. It's the only way it can come. It can't come any other way. Unless you're in God, filled with God, right? You're not going to be intimate with God. You have to get intimate with Him. That's the only way that godly enthusiasm can come. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 57, Paul writes, But thank God, He gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. Always work, what? Enthusiastically for the Lord. For you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. Paul said, work enthusiastically for the Lord. Work for the Lord. If you're taking notes, write this one down. It's not what you do that makes it meaningful. It's who you do it for. Did you catch that? It's not what you do that makes it meaningful. It's who you do it for. Like, I'll give you an example. Something totally stupid and off the wall, but I remembered this. I was like, Lord, what could be a really just a dumb example, right? Here's my dumb example. At night, when Mama Bear and I are getting ready to call it a night and head to bed, right? She doesn't turn off one light in the house. She doesn't. You know why? Because she knows I'm going to do it for her. Baby, you go crawl in bed. I got this. I turn off the lights for her. I want to go around and check my house, check the windows, make sure everything's cool, and I start turning off the lights. She just crawls up in bed and she's all good, right? She doesn't worry about it. I do it for her, and I do it enthusiastically, right? I'll come in the room and the bedroom light's still on. I think, well, you could have at least turned that one off, you know, but she's still on. Because you know why? Because she knows I'm going to go click, it is off. What's my point in this? Look, work for the Lord in whatever you do. Do it enthusiastically. Listen, when you work for the Lord, you transform something mundane into something meaningful. Let me give you the best example I can give you on this. This is a killer example. When I lived up in Dixon, when I'd go to the Walmart up there, I'd go to the self-checkout area. And every time I would come in there, there was this lady, older chick, man. She was cool as ice, man. Hello, how are you? I hope you're having a wonderful day. I'd be like, yeah, man, I'm having a good day. Thanks, you know, and I'd check out, you know. And it seemed like every time I go to check out, there she is. And sometimes I'd have to wait, you know, to get to the self-checkout. And I would notice her, and she'd be humming and singing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, yeah, you know. I'm like, And so one day I strike up a conversation with her. I just said, man, I said, you really have a lot of joy in your heart, don't you? She goes, I sure do, sir. She goes, I sure do. And I said, why are you so happy? Every time I see you, you're singing and you're humming. And she goes, you know what? People are so depressed anymore. And they come in here and they're just so downtrodden. And you can just tell they're going through something. And I just want to just lift them up. And so when I'm singing and stuff, I'm keeping myself in the presence of this one. And I'm like, you can say his name. She says, Jesus. I said, Jesus, right? And she says, and I just want to uplift people's spirit. And she goes, I put all I have into what I'm doing. And I went, whoa. Now, I'm going to tell you something. Walmart is not one of my top 10 places to work, right? I even put an application in there when I was retired, and things were a tough time here at the church, and they told me that they were going in a different direction. I mean, I couldn't even get a door greeter job, right? But here's the point of this story. What she's doing is who it's for. If you're taking notes, write this one down. Enthusiasm is not a product of environment as much as a posture of our hearts. Did you catch that? Enthusiasm is not a product of our environment. Some of you are so moved by everything that's going on around you, man. You just have, your stimuli is off the charts. I don't know how you have that much energy. Right? Enthusiasm is not a product of environment. It's as much a posture of your heart. What is the posture of your heart this morning, church? What is the posture of it? Because let me tell you something. You can have enthusiasm and you can lose it. I've done that. I've been through that. Some of you have too. Now, one of the most passionate and spiritually charged and enthusiastic people in the Bible is who do you think? Who comes to mind? David! Cheater, you knew the outline notes. Listen, if there was ever anybody that was passionately and spiritually charged up and enthusiastic about God, it was David. Think about David, man. He was a little boy who grew up to be a king. But here's what I want you to catch. He had spiritual enthusiasm, and then he lost it. If you go to 1 Samuel chapter 17, starting in verse 45, David said to the Philistine, you come against me with a sword, spear, and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. I can see the passion in his heart. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut your head off. Yikes. This very day I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. He is on it. David was passionate. He was enthusiastic for the things of the Lord. He says, he told him, how dare you defy the God of Israel, you dog? I mean, he's just talking crazy. But here's what I want you to catch in this. This is not human confidence, church. Remember, we talked about that last week. We talked about having godly confidence, not confidence in yourself. This was raw, unparalleled, spiritual passion that David had in theos. He was in theos. He was in God. He was enthusiastic for the things of God. And David was ready for the battle. And he knew that God was going to win. So where did David's enthusiasm come from? Where do you think David's enthusiasm comes from? Think about it, right? Well, it comes from the same enthusiasm as my humming Walmart lady. She was all in. She was all in what she was doing. She was all in with God. She was all in with what she was doing. So charging a giant? No big deal for David. Why? I'm going to give you three things this morning for you to think about. First, he trusted God daily. David trusted God daily. He had to, as a small boy. Historians think David was probably 11 or 12 years old, possibly 13, because that's the when the year of accountability comes in a young man's life, but at least 13 years old, that he was out taking care of the sheep, man. Does anybody remember the two things that he encountered when he was out there as a shepherd? The lion and the bear, man. Now, I don't know about you, but a lion and a bear are not two things I want to encounter. First off, they're two of the most ferocious animals when they get upset. They are just no fun. But yet, God gave him the strength to confront the lion and the bear. And God delivered him. And this prepared David for a later time in his life, when another ferocious being or person was going to try to kill him by the name of Saul. David was ready. Number two, he walked with God daily. He trusted God daily. He walked with God daily. What does that mean? That means in everything that he did throughout his day, God was central, central in it. When David penned, "The Lord is my shepherd," he could pin it because it was the truth. Can you say the same thing this morning? Is the Lord really your shepherd? Or is it your checkbook? Is it the money in your bank account? Is it your house or your cars? Is it your job? What is the shepherd of your life? For David, it was God. No Sunday church for him. Oh, no, he's all in. He's in church 7 days a week, man, because he loves God. He's in it to win it. So he trusted God daily. He walked with God daily. And the third thing is, he worshiped God daily. Let me ask you this. Just keep it to yourself. How many times this week did you worship the Lord? How many times? Oh, God, Pastor, I worship God on my job. That's my ministry. Shut up. Really? How often did you worship the Lord this week? I mean, really worship the Lord. Throw some worship music on and get your groove on and be in your house singing and dancing and stuff like that. Or sitting before the Lord and reading his word and giving him honor and glory and praise for who he is. That's worship, man. We've got this mindset in the church today. Worshiping God is my whole life. It is. But let's understand what that word really meant. It was an intimate time of being with God and praising him and singing to him. When the Ark of the Covenant was brought into Jerusalem after having a 20-year hiatus, David basically strips down to his underwear. He's in his boxers, jumping around, dancing and singing and praising God for his goodness as it's being brought in. He's worshiping with all his might. And he was worshiping so hard that his wife, Michal, despised him, it says. And God cursed her for that. Now, worshiping God daily, that means worshiping God daily. That means setting aside time and worshiping the Lord in heaven. Jews worshiped him every day. They had to set aside time. So trusting God, walking with God, and worshiping God, guess what's going to happen? You're going to be filled with God. You're going to be filled with God. And that's what happened to David in his early life. But you have to remember, there was two seasons in David's life. There was the season when he was a kid, and there was the season when he was a king. When he's a kid, he runs into battle. I'm in, I'm going, I'm passionate, I'm enthusiastic. But when he becomes a king, and kings go off to war, he stayed home, hung out on the rooftop. Yikes. I want to share with you two things about that. Two things, two bullet points that I have. When he was a kid, David had enthusiasm. David ran into the battle to serve his God. But when he was a king, David had apathy. And David walked on the roof to serve his comfort. How did a man who had such enthusiasm as a kid lose it as a king? Everybody needs to write this one down. He took his eyes off of his calling and he put it on his comfort. Yeah. That's why. He put it on his comfort. Which best represents you this morning? Are you charging into battle? Are you passionate, enthusiastic about the things the Lord is doing? Are you charging into battle, or are you comfortable and complacent? Because a lot of us are comfortable and complacent. I don't want to get out of my recliner. I don't want to go to church. I want to watch my Netflix tonight, or I want a game, or I want to watch the ball game. And then if I come to church, I'm going to bring the ball game with me. Stay home. Just watch the game. That's all you got to do. Super simple. You don't have to come to church. You need to be enthusiastic to come to church, and you need to want to come to church because God is here and God's people are here. Because I'm going to tell you something. There's two extremes that happened during COVID. Two extremes. Think about this. COVID-19 comes, everything closes down. Here's what happens. On the one extreme, people got closer to God. They got closer to God. Why? Because life slowed down. All of a sudden, I had time to read the Word. All of a sudden, I had time to listen to worship music. All of a sudden, I had time to reflect on who God is in my life. So you had those people who grew closer to God during COVID. But sadly, on the other end, and we're still seeing it today, because look, there's hardly anybody here in church again. Sadly, they go the other way. They walk away from God. They don't get close to God. They walk away from God. And human nature takes over for most people. And we don't drift towards discipline or towards health or towards good decisions. We drift towards complacency. We drift towards apathy. We drift towards a self-centered attitude. That's what normally happens. So we get bored. We spiritually disengage. We're suddenly binge-watching everything, right? We're just on the TV's on all day long, and we watched 50 million shows, and it's crazy what happened. And what happens is, sadly, we get in this place of apathy and comfort, and our passion is gone. And what we once had is no more, church. Which best describes you this morning? Which one? Which one is it? David had it, church, but then it was gone. You know the story of David. He's on the roof. He should have been out with his boys. He should have been out handling his business as a king, leading his men. But he didn't. He wanted to stay home. It was all good. I got Joab. I got Abishai. They got this. And he sees this woman on the roof across from him, bathing. He sees something he shouldn't have seen. So all it takes is one look, gentlemen. Remember that. And he says, I got to have her. And so he brings her to his home. The next thing you know, she's pregnant. Now, instead of David going, dang, I blew that one, man. That's not good. Well, I guess I better confess it and deal with my situation. He goes darker. He goes farther away from God. He says, you know what? I'll bring Uriah home, her husband. I'll get that fool drunk, send him down to his wife, and then, you know, they'll have a little playtime, and she'll be pregnant, and it'll all be good. Problem is, Uriah was more honorable and righteous than David. And so David gets him drunk, sends Uriah home, but he's like, my dudes are out there on the battlefield, man. I am not going in to have pleasure with my wife while my guys are out there. And he slept on his doorstep. Now David really goes dark, and he tells Joab, kill him. Put him in the front of the battle, which Uriah should have never been because he was one of the mighty men. He would have been leading a battalion, a group of guys. Rather, they put him out there with the newbies, and he's killed. David thinks it's all good. Yeah, it's all good. Sin had taken over, and it grew, and David didn't even see it. Until the man of God comes, Nathan, the prophet, and confronts him and tells David, dude, you've blown it. You've blown it, man. And God ain't happy. And David realizes how far he's fallen. Church, listen to me. Sometimes we don't even know how far we have fallen. We don't realize it. Until all of a sudden, we're looking up and we're going, Lord, how did I ever get in this position? I'm telling you, the minute that God reveals to you that you're in a bad place, you need to go to the Lord and seek him out and say, Lord, my bad, help me. Because the devil will tell you, well, don't even do it because you're just going to fall into the same sin again. I don't care if you fall into it 2 million times. Honor the Lord and go back and tell the Lord, my bad. He'll honor that. Nathan tells him, dude, you're done. And what is David's reply? Psalm 51. And this is where I go every time I'm stupid. Verse 10 says, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Renew me, Lord. And verse 12 says, restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Do you remember the joy of your salvation the first day that you tasted and knew that that Jesus was good? That's what David's talking about. Take me back to that moment, God, when I first realized who you were. Church, this is why David was a man after God's own heart. Because even though David could fall into the depravity that he did, when his eyes were opened, he repented. Jesus said to the church in Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2, verse 4, but I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you first did. Look how far you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the works you did at first. Think about that. The love you once had is gone. You've walked away. You've let go. You surrendered it. You are forsaken the first love that you had. Church, let me tell you something. You didn't lose it, you left it. You didn't lose it, you left it. You don't lose anything with God, but you can leave. Church, for just a moment, you might do this. Consider how you've drifted. Consider the intimacy that you once had. Consider that you've walked away from God, that you don't have the same passion, the same enthusiasm. Because in closing, I told you there's two types of people. Those who let circumstances influence their enthusiasm, and those who use their enthusiasm to influence their circumstances. I told you, enthusiasm is not a product of our environment. It's a posture of your heart, right? It's a posture of your heart. Let that sink in. Let that sink in for a moment. Enthusiasm is not a product of your environment. It's a posture of your heart. If you can grasp that this morning, church, it will change your lives drastically. Because think about how enthusiasm could change the climate around you. When you're enthusiastic, genuinely enthusiastic, it changes everything. If you would be enthusiastic on your job because you're serving God, you're serving God on your job. Some of you are dishonoring the Lord by what you do on your job. And then you wonder why God isn't blessing you. It's because you're dishonoring Him. You're dishonoring Him. You're not doing what you're supposed to do. Well, they're not paying me enough money, so I'm going to take this. Then go get another job. It's not your right to steal anything from your employer. You have no right to take from your employer anything. That's stealing. And then you wonder why God's not blessing you? Do your best. Leave it all on the field, man. Go and change your environment at work by changing your thinking at work, by realizing that I need to be enthusiastic about the Lord and serve God on my job, it will change everything. Change our thinking and get our passion back. That's what God is telling us this morning. It's like I was talking to a brother 2 weeks ago, and he told me this, man, and it would just set in my spirit. He says, man, there used to be a time when I had to go to church, but now I get to go to church. And he enthusiastically comes here every day. You know why? Because he loves the Lord. And he wants to be in fellowship with God's people. And he wants to come here and just praise God. He's not looking for anything other than, I'm here. I love this dude. I love his honesty. I love his heart. We get to come to church. We need to change that attitude. When you have an I have to go to church attitude, not good. It's not good. And you got to fight through it. Sometimes people ask me, well, how do you keep your passion all the time? And if you know me, my answer is I don't. I don't. Listen, it's not natural. It's not natural. I have bad days. I have some really bad days. And there's days when I feel like I'm under attack more than I ever have. And my faith is under attack. And my mind gets under attack. I mean, even my mood gets under attack, man. Mama Bear will say amen to that one. Boy, I can get it. Right? So what do I do? When I'm in that position, what do? I'm going to tell you what I do. I go back. And I think of what I was before I met Jesus. I think of the garbage that I was, the worthless person that I was, and how he could love me, a person like that. Because I don't deserve anything God's given me, man. Nothing. I don't deserve anything. I don't even deserve to be breathing right now. But because he loved me, because he loved me, he reached out to me and he said, come, come, you burdened down piece of garbage. Come, and I'm going to make you different. And it's going to be a lifelong process. He's working on me now. But I was delivered from sin and death through Jesus Christ, our Lord, church. And that should be our enthusiasm and our joy. And so I go back to trusting, walking, and worshiping God. And my enthusiasm comes back. And my joy comes back. And my passion comes back. And so this morning, church, maybe some of you need to do what I did. You need to cry out to God. You need to cry out to God and say, give me a clean heart, man. Return me to the joy of your salvation. That first time that I knew you were real. And I'm telling you, if you do, God will raise up in you a standard. And man, you'll be here an hour early because you'll be so excited just to be coming and hanging out and being in the house of the Lord. And you'll be singing songs on your job, and people will be going like, what is wrong with that person, man? You'll be like, I got the joy of the Lord, baby. You know, you want some of this? It's free 93, right? So come and get your passion back. Come, says the Lord, and I will renew you and restore you. Amen? Amen. So, Father, thank you for the reminder of how easy it is for us to fall, and we don't even know. We don't even see it. And Lord, why would somebody want to be a Christian if all we do is complain and gripe and mope around? And I wouldn't want to be one. Lord, help us today to change our thinking. Help us to change our thoughts. Help us to change our mindset. Bring that entheos back to us, Lord. And help us, Lord, to want to be intimate with you and spend time with you, God. And that can only happen through the power of the Holy Spirit. So thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. And we offer this to you now in Jesus' name, and all the church said, amen, amen, amen. Gentlemen, we have a men's retreat coming up in October. If you've never been on a men's retreat, they're life-changing. I'm telling you. They're amazing. It's in October. I'm not sure about the dates. I can't remember. But you can talk to Chris and Rick. It was on the screen. Thank you, Claude. Thank you. Thank you, Claude. 14th through the 16th, right? It's $120 for cabins. It's 220 double occupancy, hostile tile rooms. You can all read that. Registration begins on the 2nd, all right? So like I said, if you've never been on a retreat, even if you can just go up for one day, go. It will be an incredible time. You're just going to get away and be with a bunch of dudes and hang out, and you're just going to talk Jesus, man, and you're going to be encouraged, and you're going to come back, and you're going to be refreshed, and you're going to be ready to do what God's called you to do. So, like I said, get with Chris and Rick on that one there. We'll have flyers for you next week. Dinner and discussion on Wednesday night. We will be starting the book of Mark the first Wednesday in September. So we will have dinner, and then we're going to be in the book of Mark. So that's what we have. Anything else going on that we need to know about? No? All right. Hey, have a fantastic rest of your day.
Like the beating of life in my veins, I know there's gonna be some brighter days. I know there's gonna be some brighter days.